The most astounding fact is the knowledge that the atoms that comprise life on Earth, the atoms that make up the human body, are traceable to the crucibles that cooked light elements into heavy elements in their core. These stars went unstable in their later years. They collapsed and then exploded, scattering their enriched guts across the galaxy. Guts made of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and all the fundamental ingredients of life itself. These ingredients become part of gas clouds that condense, collapse, form the next generation of solar systems, stars with orbiting planets. And those planets now have the ingredients for life itself. So that when I look up at the night sky, and I know that, yes, we are part of this universe, we are in this universe, but perhaps more important than both of those facts is that the universe is in us. When I reflect on that fact, I look up. Many people feel small because they're small and the universe is big, but I feel big because my atoms came from those stars.
What if you didn't have to do anything about anything at all? Nothing at all to do, nothing at all to do about anything. Yes, make a cup of tea because that doesn't give you any trouble. Whatever it is you have to do, answer the phone, make this appointment, whatever. But it's not accompanied by this idea that there is something that I need to do to be stable in the awareness, because I tell you that is a trap. Forget about it. If you touch this idea, you believe it instantly into existence. And then you have to believe another idea to remove it. So why not drop both ideas in the first place and stay where you are? You're simply here, within which all that arises for you, including the sense of spirituality, forget about spirituality. Forget about enlightenment and forget about you also. And what remains here? That which cannot be gotten rid of remains. It's just that, simpler than simple. You're simply here. Sometimes we overuse the intellectual faculties. All this knowledge that we acquire, called spiritual knowledge, is only a mirror for the timeless to see itself. Give up all your notions, all your effort to try and get somewhere. Just drop it right here now. Because you have the power to do it. Just drop it. Yes. Just like you're sitting in a restaurant full of people, clinking glasses and utensils and stuff, and talking, and there's music, and yet you can have a sweet conversation with your friend sitting across the table. Because you don't let it in. In the same way, you don't let these thoughts in. That there's something that I need to do to just to stay more present. And the minute you are without this thought, your recognition is here. That I simply am.
Of a guru, that is to say a spiritual teacher in India, is to give you a funny look in the eye, because you come to him and say, Mr. Guru, I have problems. I suffer, and it's a mess, and I can't control my mind, and I'm miserable and depressed, and so on. And he gives you a funny look, and you feel a bit nervous about the way he looks at you, because he's reading your thoughts. And you know all the dreadful things you've thought, and you are rather embarrassed that this man looks right through you and sees them all. But that's not what he's looking at. He's giving you a funny look for quite another reason altogether. Because he sees in you the Brahman, the Godhead, just claiming it's poor little me.
Absolutely involve yourself with everything. The earth that you walk upon, the food that you eat, the water that you drink, the air that you breathe, and the very space in which you exist. You are involved. If you are not involved with the air that you breathe, you would be dead, isn't it? You are anyway involved. You just have to become conscious that this is the only way life happens. You have to see that you're consciously involved. If you're unconsciously involved, it looks like one big burden. If you're consciously involved, it will become blissful. Do you know scientifically today we can prove every subatomic particle in your body is right now in communication with the whole cosmos. Such a big phenomena, you're trying to ignore. That is your crime. Your crime is you're trying to ignore such a big phenomenon. mind, which is the basis of your life and creation. Because you ignore that, you suffer. Let your involvement become indiscriminate. You don't have a perspective of who you are. You think too much of yourself. As a physical form, what are you in this cosmos? Tell me. In your home, you may be something. On the street, not much. In the town, nothing. In the cosmos, you're not even a speck of dust. Please get the perspective right. As a physical existence, you're really nothing. Isn't it? If you understand this, you would know. You would look at everything with absolute wonder and involvement.
Modern science is just now coming around to the conclusions held by yogic science for millennia, to an explanation of our universe that's going to take our understanding to a whole new level. And that is that both the substance and the intention of the universe come from a deeper reality than the material one we normally perceive with our minds and senses. And that reality is consciousness, an all-pervading, blissful awareness inherent in everybody and everything. Just as your own consciousness is the essence of your own mind, cosmic consciousness is the essence of the entire universe. It exists within everything, and everything exists within it. Essentially, everybody and everything is part of and full of consciousness. Imagine that. However, we've largely given up on the idea of a higher consciousness in our modern worldview. Take the case of a light bulb, for example. A light bulb is capable of shining light on the room around it, but not on the power which illuminates it. In the same way, we're capable of comprehending the world around us, but not the consciousness which animates us. It's beyond the normal functioning of the mind, beyond words, beyond even thought itself. The core of our being is not something that can even be spoken about, let alone thought of. I think we're all familiar with this saying by Descartes, I think therefore I am. But this is what yogic philosophy says. When I stop thinking, then I really am.
We have taken far too much responsibility for what is happening, and that what we took to be a staircase we were climbing is actually an up escalator. And if you will stop climbing, you will notice that it does not impede your upward progress, because the ground you're standing on is moving you toward the goal. And I think that this idea, which may be the proof that I'm bonkers, requires a fairly radical reorganization of consciousness. Because what I'm saying is the universe was not born in a fiery explosion from which it has been being blasted outward ever since. The universe is not being pushed like that from behind. The universe is being pulled from the future toward a goal that is as inevitable as a marble reaching the bottom of a bowl when you release it up near the rim. You know, if you do that, the marble will roll down the side of the bowl, down, 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 and eventually it will come to rest in the lowest energy state, which is the bottom of the bowl. Bear in mind what the competition is peddling. The competition is peddling the idea that the universe sprang from nothing in a single moment for no reason. Now, whatever you think about that, notice that it's the limit case for credulity. Do you understand what I mean? I mean, if you can believe that, it's hard for me to imagine what you would balk at. If we were to sit down and say, let's see who can think of the most unlikely thing that could possibly happen, I submit to you, nobody could top the Big Bang. It is the improbability of improbabilities. It is the mother of all improbabilities right there. So I'm suggesting something different. I'm suggesting that the universe is pulled toward a complex attractor that exists ahead of us in time, and that our ever-accelerating speed through the phenomenal world of connectivity and novelty is based on the fact that we are now very, very close to the attractor. Thank you.
Now, it's difficult to imagine a society more different from the society of ancient Egypt than our society today. We hate visionary states in this society. In our society, if we want to insult somebody, we call them a dreamer. In ancient societies, that was praise. And we have erected huge apparatuses of armed bureaucracies who will invade our privacy, who will break down our doors, who will arrest us, who will send us to prison, sometimes for years, for possessing even small quantities of psilocybin or substances like DMT. And it's not as though our society is opposed in principle to altered states of consciousness. I mean, billions are being made by the unholy alliance of psychiatrists and big pharma in over-prescribing drugs to control so-called syndromes like depression or attention deficit disorder in teenagers. And we have a love affair in our society with alcohol. We glorify this most boring of drugs. And of course, we love our stimulants, our tea, our coffee, our energy drinks, our sugar, and huge industries are built around these substances, which are valued because of the way they alter consciousness. But what all these approved altered states of consciousness have in common is that none of them contradict or conflict with the basic state of consciousness valued by our society, which I would call the alert, problem-solving state of consciousness. But I think everybody realizes that the promise of a society over-monopolistically based upon this state of consciousness has proved hollow. And that this model is no longer working. That it's broken in every possible sense that a model can be broken, and urgently we need to find something to replace it. The vast problems of global pollution that have resulted from the single-minded pursuit of profit, the horrors of nuclear proliferation, the specter of hunger that millions every night go to bed starving, that we can't even solve this problem despite our alert problem-solving state of consciousness. And look what's happening in the Amazon, the lungs of our planet, this precious home of biodiversity. The old-growth rainforest being cut down and replaced with soybean farms so we can feed cattle, so that we can all eat hamburgers. Only a truly insane global state of consciousness could allow such an abomination to occur. And I did a back-of-an-envelope calculation during the Iraq War. It seems to me that 6 months' expenditure on the Iraq War would have solved the problem of the Amazon forever. Would be sufficient to compensate the peoples of the Amazon so that no single tree ever needed to be cut down again to garden and look after that amazing resource. But we can't make that decision as a global community. We can spend countless billions on warfare, on hatred, on fear, on suspicion, on division. But we can't get together the collective effort to save the lungs of our planet. When I've asked shamans about the sickness of the West, they say it's quite simple. You guys have severed your connection with spirit. Unless you reconnect with spirit and do so soon, you're going to bring the whole house of cards down around your heads and ours. And I stand here invoking the hard-won right of freedom of speech to call for and demand another right to be recognized, and that is the right of adult sovereignty over consciousness. There's a war on consciousness in our society, and if we as adults are not allowed to make sovereign decisions about what to experience with our own consciousness while doing no harm to others, then we cannot claim to be free in any way, and it's useless for our society to go around the world imposing our form of democracy on others while we nourish this rot at the heart of society. It may even be that we're denying ourselves the next vital step in our own evolution by allowing this state of affairs to continue, and who knows, perhaps our immortal destiny as well.
When you look at a computer screen that's picking up the internet, the pictures can look solid. They can look like a solid world on the screen. And in the same way, we are picking up information from this, what I call the cosmic internet. The five senses are turning it from vibrational information into electrical information, which then is decoded by the brain into this world that we think is outside of us, because that's the illusion, but actually is only exists in our head, only exists when we decode it. This reality only exists in this physical sense when it's observed. What I would say, when we've decoded it from the information construct into this holographic reality we call the physical world. And this is why quantum physicists look inside the atom, which they say, of course, atoms make up this physical world, but inside the atom is nothing. It's just empty. How can something that's not solid make up a solid world? Answer, it doesn't. It's all an illusion in the decoding process. So, if someone said to me, what is this universe at its foundation, I would say, it's information. What is the wireless internet? It is information. The computer takes that information, turns it into a collective reality. We take that information through the body computer and turns that into this apparent reality. Only instead of being on a screen, the screen is in here. When we look out of the window, we might see a blue car go past the house. Someone else will see the same blue car because we're all decoding the same information. What then happens, this is where the uniqueness comes from, we then decide what we think of that car. We then view this decoded reality in different ways, and that's what makes us different.
understanding of Zen, the understanding of awakening, the understanding of, well, we'll call it mystical experience, is one of the most dangerous things in the world. And for a person who cannot contain it, it's like putting 1,000,000 volts through your electric shaver. You blow your mind and it stays blown. Now, if you go off in that way, that is what would be called in Buddhism a pracheka Buddha, private Buddha. He's one who goes off into the transcendental world and is never seen again. And he's made a mistake from the standpoint of Buddhism, because from the standpoint of Buddhism, there is no fundamental difference between the transcendental world and this everyday world. The Bodhisattva, you see, who doesn't go off into a nirvana and stay there forever and ever, but comes back and lives ordinary everyday life to help other beings to see through it too, he doesn't come back because he feels he has some sort of solemn duty to help mankind and all that kind of pious cant. He comes back because he sees the two worlds are the same. He sees all other beings as Buddhas. He sees them, to use a phrase of G.K. Chesterton's, but now a great thing in the street seems any human nod, where move in strange democracy the 1,000,000 masks of God. Fantastic to look at people and see that they really, deep down, are enlightened. They're it. Their faces are the divine. And they look at you and say, oh no, but I'm not divine, I'm just ordinary little me. And you look at them in a funny way, and here you see the Buddha nature looking out of their eyes straight at you, and saying it's not. And saying it quite sincerely.
I could paint for you, I would paint for you. But my thing is words. Words. But the problem about words is that you may listen to them. And that would be a mistake. For all I am doing is painting with words. And the message that is being sent is nonverbal. Anything you write down in a notebook, take home to think about, forget it. For in fact, I'm not going to say anything that you don't know already. But the perplexing problem is that you don't know you know. Chung Tzu says, the fish trap exists because of the fish. Once you've gotten the fish, you can forget the trap. The rabbit snare exists because of the rabbit. Once you've gotten the rabbit, you can forget the snare. Words exist because of meaning. Once you've gotten the meaning, you can forget the words. You don't have to try. You don't even have to listen. We just have to be together. And it'll all happen.
And suddenly I was thrown into this expansive, amazing feeling of freedom from myself, from my problems. I saw that I was bigger than what I do. I was bigger than my body. I was everything and everyone. I was no longer a fragment of the universe. I was the universe. And ever since that day, I've been trying to get back there. It comes and it goes. It's like riding a wave. Sometimes I'm on, sometimes I'm off. But at least I know where I want to go. And that I want to take as many people with me as I possibly can, because the feeling is amazing.
Took 3 hard days of labor, sweating, aching, but I had faith. So I kept on pushing those wheelbarrows, but I must admit, when it was all over after 3 days, I was very happy. I thought, wow, we finished it. Tomorrow I can have a rest, I can meditate. The following morning, after breakfast, the monk in charge, the deputy monk, he brought all the monks together and said, I've been thinking, I don't think that's the right place for the earth. Let's move it round the corner. Now that was testing my faith. But I thought, no, I respect that monk too. I'm a Buddhist, I will let go, I will push those wheelbarrows. For another 3 days of hard work, toiling under the hot conditions of a Thai jungle, after another 3 days, we'd finished. Now I was really happy, really relieved. We'd moved it and they were happy. But that night, Ajahn Chah came back. And yes, you've guessed what happened. He got all the monks together and he said, what did you put it there for? I told you to put it over here. Move it. Another 3 days of pushing wheelbarrows. I didn't become a monk to push wheelbarrows. I didn't, you know, put on the yellow robes to be exploited like this. We monks should form a union. We should stand up for our rights. Because the senior monks, they didn't push any wheelbarrows. They were just telling us what to do. So I got very upset. I got very angry. In fact, I started swearing in English so the Thais couldn't understand. They did understand, because they see my facial expressions. And one monk came up to me, and he gave me a teaching which helped me for so many years. He said, pushing the wheelbarrow is easy. Thinking about it is the hard part. Pushing the wheelbarrow is easy. Thinking about it is the hard part. How true that was. As soon as I stopped complaining, as soon as I stopped thinking about it and just pushed that wheelbarrow was lighter. And there was no suffering anymore. There was the thinking which caused me the suffering. Whatever test you have in life, stop thinking about it so much. Just do it. In your life, do you think too much? Thinking too much is a great cause of suffering. There's so many things in life you just have to do, so stop complaining. But you know, that only worked for a short time, because later on, now I did complain even more about what it was like to be a young monk in Thailand. You know, I was much thinner as a young monk than I am now. When they say that Buddhism is growing in the West, this is what they mean. That my trouble, the reason why I'm fat, it's not that I eat too much, I don't worry enough. But no, when I was a young monk, I was so thin. And one of the reasons was, whenever we got any food, it was given to the senior monks first. They took their share and they passed it down the line of monks according to seniority. So by the time it came to me, there was only the remains left, what everyone else didn't want. I thought that was so unfair. Because after all those senior monks, they were probably already enlightened. They didn't need nice food. It was me who needed the nice food. I could appreciate it, they wouldn't even appreciate it. Anything would be good for them. And all the senior monks, they'd have all these big cushions. And the junior monks, we had to sit on the hard concrete. And I thought, I was so thin and bony. I was the one who needed the cushions. Those fat monks, they had their own upholstery. And they made us work so hard. And they never did any work, they just sat around talking to people all day. Oh, it was so unfair. So I complained. And one of the monks said to me, "You've got what we call young monk suffering. When you become a senior monk, you'll be fat, you'll have the choice of food, you'll have the biggest cushions, you'll have senior monk suffering." And sometimes I do that. I think, all those young monks, they don't have to give talks all day. They don't have to listen to people talking about their children, their marriage, their finances, and everything else. I became a monk to get rid of all that stuff. And that's called old monk suffering. Now the point is, you're not getting rid of suffering, are you? In my monastery, some years ago, two Thai girls came to see me. They were sisters. These two ladies came to see me. The first one, her problem, she was married, she had a husband, she was having a lot of suffering with her husband. He was giving her a very difficult time. She had husband suffering. Then I asked her, "Sister, what's your problem?" And she said, "I'm single."
I want a husband, I can't find one. But afterwards I told her, madam, the one who's married, you've got married woman suffering. You've got single woman suffering. If you get rid of your husband, you won't have married woman suffering anymore. You'll have single woman suffering. And you, if you want a husband, you won't have single woman suffering anymore. You'll have married woman suffering. You don't get rid of the suffering, do you?
There are basically two kinds of philosophy. One's called prickles, the other's called goo. And prickly people are precise, rigorous, logical. They like everything chopped up and clear. Goo people like it vague. For example, in physics, prickly people believe that the ultimate constituents of matter are particles. Goo people believe it's waves. And philosophy, prickly people are logical positivists and goo people are idealists. And they're always arguing with each other. And what they don't realize is that neither one can take his position without the other person. Because you wouldn't know you advocated prickles unless there was somebody else advocating goo. You wouldn't know what a prickle was unless you knew what goo was. Because life is not either prickles or goo, it's gooey prickles and prickly goo. And they go together, like back and front, male and female. And that's the answer to philosophy. See, I'm a philosopher. And I'm not going to argue very much, because if you don't argue with me, I don't know what I think. So if we argue, I say thank you. Because going to the courtesy of your taking a different point of view, I understand what I mean. So I can't get rid of you.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
entire existence is right now, okay, in this moment. Now, this is not about living in the moment. The moment you make a philosophy, live in the moment. You know, this philosophy is going all over the world. Live in the moment, live in the moment. It started in America, now it's also into urban India. Live in the moment. I'm asking you, please live somewhere else and show me, please. Can you? Why such a teaching? Why do you need such a teaching that live in the moment? Because anyway, do whatever you want, you can only be in the moment. You cannot be anywhere else. Only thing is, what they're telling you is, do not think about yesterday, do not think about tomorrow, which is what you were referring to in some way. The significance of being human is, I remember the yesterday vividly, my experience of yesterday, and I can imagine tomorrow's yet-to-be situation vividly and create that. You have been given a supercomputer and you did not bother to read the, you know, user's manual. Without you reading the user's manual, you try to handle this, it's a mess. Because it's a mess, people are saying, you must dull the mind. Do not remember yesterday, do not think about tomorrow, just do what you're doing today. You will do meaningless things. You cannot do anything significant. The power of being human is, we remember not only our experience, we remember the experience of the entire world.
Right.
Yes?
Absolutely.
This is what makes us who we are. Because of this, that we don't have to actually go through what a billion people have gone through, in some way we have made that our experience. Because of that, we can imagine something that we can create tomorrow, and human life goes on. Now the problem is, all this is coming because joyless people, they feel little peaceful when they don't think about yesterday and tomorrow. Yes? That's the only problem. So I am talking about a chemistry of blissfulness. You know, all human experience is based in your chemistry. What you call as joy, what you call as love, at least for love, everybody is using the chemistry business.
Okay.
Of blissfulness. It is your physiological and psychological situation that you have to manage. You can't manage the cosmic situation. You only have to manage your physiological and psychological situation. If you manage this well, the world is there, always.